And so I would like for you, if you would, to turn with me to 2 Timothy. Imagine that.
Mm-hmm.
2 Timothy, the second chapter. And I just want to share with you just a little bit. Since it's my 22nd anniversary, I should be able to preach as long as I want.
Amen.
If you all would stay, then I'd be happy. Amen. 2 Timothy, the second chapter. We'll get a running start at what we want to share, and let the Lord be glorified. 2 Timothy, the second chapter, 15th verse. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. And their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is already past already, and have overthrown the faith of some. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, that the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity.
Amen.
As we get into this message this morning, I want you to understand this fundamental truth that this last verse has just expressed to you, that if you're going to be a Christian, you need to separate yourself from the world in the way that the world does.
Right.
There are many different facets of Scripture that will look and show you this truth. All you have to do is read it or study the Bible, so you'll see what the Bible says, rather than believing a preacher, or rather than believing what your parents may have believed, or whatever that it may be. You need to study for yourself, and when you do that, there will be Scriptures that come to the surface, and you'll say, wow, I think Brother Scott said that one time.
Right.
And see, you thought I'd come up with all this, but no. I studied the Bible to see what the Bible said so that I could live my life according to what the Bible said, and then in so doing, be a servant to God that's not ashamed of the way that I'm living my life. A lot of people need to be ashamed, and our culture is totally removing shame from things that are wrong. Amen. And then they're placing shame on things that are right.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
You have to be very careful, and you get sucked into it before you know it. Now, I don't want to preach about that, but I will. y'all's going to hate me. You know, do you hate me because I tell you the truth?
Come on.
And let me tell you, okay, I'll just go ahead and do it. And some of you get sucked into it. Now, I'm not picking on anybody. I haven't looked at anybody, and I'll close my eyes while I say it so that you don't think I'm looking at you. We have a culture now, the Bible said, would come that the people would worship the creation more than the creator.
Uh-huh.
And when animals are elevated over human life, then we have a problem. And some of you get sucked into that because animals are cute. According to the world today, David would have been a bad guy because he slew a lion and a bear.
Right.
And why?
Right.
Because that they went and they killed the sheep. Well, guess what? You complain about starving people in Africa, and then when somebody kills a lion, it kills goats and sheep.
Right. Come on.
Mm-hmm. Wait a minute. Now, what if one of them shepherds had killed a lion? Would you be just as mad? So then you have respect to persons of who killed the lion.
Right.
Oh, no.
Right.
And the same people who go on Facebook and talk about Cecil the Lion, the nice Cecil the Lion. I saw a picture and they said he had a goat in his mouth, but I don't know if it was the same Cecil. The same people who do that will have no respect to the sanctity of human life. And in our country right now, you're putting in political parties who destroy babies, one right after the other, and then sell the parts, and you sit there and talk about lying in Africa.
Amen.
Okay. Hate me if you want. Here we go. Oh, I didn't want to preach on that. That's foolishness. That's foolishness. It's as foolish as the day is long. You know what I mean? Now, David in the Bible was considered courageous for going up against a lion, but you know it's unsportsman because the there's another scripture that said slew a lion in a pit on a snowy day. You remember that scripture, Sister Shelley? It talked about this man and it talked about his valor. And I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to go against a lion. I'd do it if the Lord, you know, required it of me. It talked about the valor of this one man, and his notable feat was he slew a lion in a pit on a snowy day, which means it was extra hard to do, you know, I guess, or whatever. But I don't want to get into all the animal rights and the worship and the creation, but I'll tell you, you know what, if we protect turtle eggs and if we protect eagles' nests, but we don't protect the unborn, we're doing ourselves idiocy, disservice, and you need to be careful that you don't get sucked into what the world is calling right and what the world is calling wrong. Because the world will let you get by with every kind of perversion under the sun with no shame, at the same time saying that God is shameful in the things that He requires of us to do as regarding the way we live our lives.
Right.
But nothing is wrong. And I'm going to tell you, you know, it's so bad that if we don't begin to take charge of our lives, and if we don't begin to speak out, pretty soon the freedom of being able to speak out will be gone, and then you'll be left in a country like Russia or China or whatever, where what you believe, you'll have to believe in secret, and then you'll have to worry or fear of being dragged into courts and being charged with hating people or disrespecting people or whatever. Well, let me tell you something. God desires you to live a life that is sanctified.
Right.
Amen.
That's right.
Let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. I guess to depart from iniquity, we would have to define that what iniquity is, right? And iniquity is the same as sin. And so basically what this is saying is, let every one of you who name the name of Christ depart from doing evil things. Depart from iniquity means to depart from evil and don't do it. Don't get sucked into it. Don't promote it. Don't even enjoy watching people who are doing it. And the scripture says the same thing. You'll read it one time in your study and say, oh, look. So these people have been teaching something about the coming of the Lord that was incorrect and had begun to spread that like a disease in churches. And Paul called them out right here in this letter to Timothy in the church, and then named them by name. And he said their word does eat like a canker. And then he goes on to say, let every one of them that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. My message today is, are you identified with the sanctified? Amen?
Amen.
It's a little catchy, so you'll remember it. Some of the New Testament letters are written to churches, and the way that it starts is like, to the faithful brethren and to them that are sanctified at the church of Ephesus or Colossus or Thessalonica, or to the faithful brethren or to the saints. And I like one that says, to those who are called to be saints. Amen. Now, what happens is we've allowed the cultural relevance to dictate to us who's a saint, and we allow the universal church to say that only special people are supposed to be sanctified or set apart for the ministry, and then we elevate them to sainthood, and we put them on a pedestal and say, but the truth is that everyone who names the name of Christ should depart from iniquity.
Amen.
And be holy.
Amen.
That's right.
If we take away the righteousness from the righteous, we do a disservice to God. Many of you do that without even realizing it, saying that it can't be done, saying that, oh, that's just the way that it is. But I'm going to tell you, the power of Christ working in you is nothing short of miraculous.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
It is not based on our good works that any of us should boast, but it is based on the work of Christ. And when you say you can't do it, what you're saying is your God cannot do it.
That's right.
Because my God tells me that I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. And He wants me to depart from iniquity. And so He's going to give you the power to do just that. We have been lulled to sleep by society saying that nothing is wrong. If you look at the last 50 years alone from the culture of the 1950s, since this church has been to existence, I'll take you to 61, black and white TV until now, you'll see the difference between Mayberry and The Simpsons.
Right.
I mean, I've never watched The Simpsons much. I know who the characters are pretty much because it's old. That's old news now. Who is it now? You tell me. You know, they try to
Modern Family.
A Modern Family. I don't even want to. What it is you see the degradation of morality, and what it is they slip in front of you all the things that are evil, all the things that are wrong, as if it's normal, and then they will marginalize your speech or your conversation that you even feel bad about saying that it's wrong,
right?
Even when it is wrong, and then all of a sudden, iniquity is at the door. If you remember what God said to Cain, I love to use that as an illustration because a lot of people don't understand that there is a if-then principle in the Bible. And,
right.
And Cain had choices that he made, and he allowed the enemy to creep in him through jealousy or whatever, envy, and creep in him. And what God told him is said, Cain, if you do well, won't you be accepted? But if not, sin is lying at the door.
Mm.
And what's going to happen? Cain walked through that door and sin jumped on him and he killed his brother. And that was a ugly end to that story. But it was part of God's plan, highlighting the fact that we have choices to make and that there are bad things in the world. And I want to tell you that God wants you to be something different than what this world offers as a way of life. He wants you to live a life that is sanctified or set apart so that men will see your good works and then glorify Him in heaven. And how do they do that? Because they'll realize that a normal person couldn't do that.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you something else. Normal people can't do what God has called them to do. But with the strength of the Spirit of God working in you, you can do it.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen. Amen.
I've not cussed all this week.
Amen.
Again.
Come on.
Amen. I've strung a few weeks together this year. You all would be proud of me.
Come on.
You say, what has that got to do with anything? You tell yourself that you can't quit cussing, and you lie to the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
You could have heard a pin drop as he stopped. Come on.
That's right.
Come on. Okay, you say, well, Brother Scott, that's you. No, it's not just me. I was a filthy sinner steeped in ungodly conversation, cursing the worst and most foul words every single day of my life, I have witnesses in this congregation who knew me before I was saved and will tell you, yes, he's telling the truth, but I'm going to tell you when Jesus Christ got a hold of my heart, he cleansed me and he purified me and he set my feet upon a solid rock where my feet don't have to slip and I don't have to backslide. I don't have to look back. I don't have to be defined by my past. I'm not that person anymore.
Amen.
Such were some of you, but now you're washed
and
now you're cleansed.
Right.
But
Amen.
You should be.
That's right.
Now listen, you go through these New Testament letters, it says, to them that are sanctified at Corinth. You know why Paul had to phrase it that way? Because there was a lot of people at Corinth that were not sanctified.
Right.
To the faithful brethren at this. You know why he had to phrase it that way? Because in a big house, there's many vessels. And he's saying some are of honor and some are dishonor. And you have to be very careful because what's going to happen is the dishonor will take over
right.
And pretty soon you'll be just like the world inside the church.
Right.
No different.
Right.
Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord,
Amen.
Is in the Bible.
Amen.
It's not just something I came up with, so we have a good church here.
Right.
It's something that God came up with, so we'd have a good church there.
Yes.
Amen. I'm going to tell you the truth, and I don't want to be your enemy because I tell you the truth. I get excited about preaching, and sometimes people mistake that for anger. I'm not mad. I'm just excited.
Amen.
Amen. You know, if you go out to a Bucks game and you say, yeah! Oh, I'm sorry. Was that fine? Let me do that again. No. Come on.
Right.
You don't mistake that for anger.
Right.
I get excited about what the Lord's done in my life. I want everybody to know about it. I don't want to see people steeped in the things of the past. I don't want to see them bound by iniquity. I don't want to see them in chains of darkness. I don't want to see them lose out on their salvation. I don't want to see them not make it into heaven. I don't want to see them go to hell. And so I want to try to help people, every kind of people. I love all kinds of people, the perverted with the just. I love them all.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
Amen.
I don't hate nobody because they live wrong. Even people that do wrong, I don't hate them. I just want them to do right.
Come on.
And so does the Lord.
Right.
I'm not the enemy. They're their own worst enemy.
Right.
Now listen, if we go through this word, you'll understand a little bit better. If I can get there. But in a great house, the 20th verse, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some honor and some dishonor. Okay, so if you're supposed to be a vessel, what kind of vessel would you like to be?
Mm-hmm.
You know, every one of you, I hope, would want to be an honorable vessel.
Right.
And I used to think, and what you have to be careful of in your spadazzo, you have to be careful of putting the wrong thing in the wrong place because you got to have the lines lining up with the Bible and that study. That's what we've been talking about for the last few weeks. Spadazzo means study. And so when you study, you have to be very careful because I used to think as a young minister that I was who I was and there's nothing I could do about who I was. God made me this way and this is who I am because of a scripture that says, what can the clay say to the potter? But then another prophet said, let's go down to the potter's house and consider the work on the wheel.
Come on.
Then it goes on here, and I think all of us, if we'd be honest, in the deepest part of our hearts, we want to be right with God.
Come on, that's right.
Amen. And in the sight of God, we want to be a vessel that he can use. Amen.
Amen.
And we want to be clean or forgiven or cleansed from iniquity and the things. I think all of us want that down deep. I know every person down deep has a yearning because the life that's in every person, it comes from God. So there's a part of God that energizes you to, it's like a homing device. It pulls you or draws you to the thing that is holy, the light per se. And so when we see the light, we want to be like the light. And so, and nobody wants to dwell in darkness, and nobody wants to hang out there. It's an ugly, ugly place. And the further you go, it's the worse it gets.
Amen.
And I remember one old rock and roll song that says, you can only tell the distance from the bottom by the company you keep. Yeah, the people you got hanging around you.
That's right.
And you have to be very careful. And so in this, he uses like a parable. He begins to talk about vessels in the same house. And we'll go back to this. But he says, some are gold and silver. Some are wood and earth. And some to honor and some to dishonor. And so if a man therefore will purge himself from these. Now, this phrase is the pivotal point of my ministry. As we've been going through the book of James on Wednesday night, you know I shared with you the last few weeks about the book of James. And the first chapter is very good. And it says things like, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask God. Do you know any man? That includes you.
Right.
If you lack wisdom or understanding, God will give it to you.
Amen.
You can study the Bible just like it's as easy as pie nowadays with all the comforts that we have. I still like the rice paper and flipping pages, but some of you might prefer the click of a mouse or the scrolling on a phone and reading the Bible and seeing what the Bible says. Well, read this verse, and this verse says, if any man will purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor.
Amen.
Amen.
Sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work.
Amen.
Now, I want to take that scripture and I want to focus in on what the Bible is telling us. Sometimes the King James English, it requires a little bit of thought to really bring home the point. But basically, this Bible says, if you'll straighten up, God can use you.
Right.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Simple.
Is that redneckish enough for you? If you'll straighten up, God can use you.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't straighten up, He's calling you to come home.
Right.
He's calling you to a different place than where you're at.
Come on.
I used to think I was resigned to the way that God created me, and God created me to be like this, so if I was malformed, what can the clay say to the potter? And it was in regards to a different set of circumstances, because in this New Testament way of looking at things, it says that a man has control over the way that he acts. Do you have control of your own self? Does Christ have control of your own self? Himself. Okay. Sanctified and meet for the master's use, prepared unto every good work. How many of you have ever said, how many of you have ever felt unworthy of doing what God has called His people to do? How many of you have ever felt like that I cannot get over what it is that has me bound? Well, let me tell you, when the anointing of God begins to flow in your life, every chain that keeps you back from being what God called you to be can be broken.
Amen.
And fall by the wayside.
Right.
All the stories of victory in the Old Testament, they were for your benefit,
right,
so that you would learn what it means to live a victorious life now. And that doesn't mean that everything's always going to go your way. What it does mean, though, is that you have power over your own self. That's why Paul would say things like, I die daily. I live, yet not I, but Christ in me, the hope of glory. Amen. And he says, I keep my body under subjection, lest by any means, after that I preach to others, I myself would be a castaway. You don't think there's been times when the devil tried to tempt me to quit?
Right.
You don't think there's times when I go by the billboard and see the things that are advertised as good for you in this world that there's not some type of little drawing that I don't have to take out a hammer and a nail and say, bam, you're not going there,
that's
buddy.
Right. Come on.
You obey me.
Yes. Right. That's right.
Amen.
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 Do you know your own self?
Come on.
Come on now. And I begin to think about this. Now, this scripture could go into many different veins of thought, but I began to think about this like in the same house are many different vessels, some to honor and some to dishonor, and you could use that like a church.
Right.
You could use it, and some of you are good, and God can use you, and some of you ain't doing right, and God don't use you hardly at all because you're all dirty.
Right. Ooh, come on now.
Cracked pot.
Hmm.
Now, I'm not looking at anybody. And you know, maybe they're not here this morning. This church is a big church. Maybe it's for somebody on the internet that'll hear this later. They ain't living right in church and want God to use them. But let me tell you now, God will use your failures for His benefit. But He can use you better if you'll get along with His program. And when it says, if any man will purge himself from these, now listen, that's what this morning I was thinking about that. I think about it as a church. I think Paul was thinking about Timothy as a young pastor, and he was looking at this. And I want you to think about this, though. The Bible talks about you being like a house, and God being able to sweep clean the corridors, the hallways, and the rooms of your heart. And says, be careful, because if you don't put the good things in there, the bad things are coming back and it's going to be worse. He said, you're like the house. And I began to think about that this morning, and I began to think about my life and how many different vessels are in my life that God can use. He can use my mouth to speak. He can use my eyes to see and get clarity of direction.
Right.
He can use my ears to hear the Word of God. He can use my fingers to type out a message on Facebook. Or hit send. How many different vessels inside my house glorify God? And so I wondered, God, is inside of me there any unclean thing that would be displeasing to you inside of my life? And so you cry out to God and you say, search me, O God.
Come on.
And see if there be any wicked way in me. And if there is, then I want it to be purged from my life. I want my life to be like your life. I want to be a living sacrifice. I want to be what you called me to be. And it's holy and acceptable to God.
Come on.
And it's not just a high calling, but it's your reasonable service.
Amen.
It's what a Christian is supposed to be.
Come on.
Let everyone that names the name apart of Christ depart from iniquity. If you'll purge yourself from these, you can be a vessel of honor. And it begins to enumerate stuff.
Hmm.
Flee youthful lust, but follow after righteousness.
Mm.
Okay. Oh. Okay. Our world will tell you that abstinence doesn't work.
Right.
That we need to educate our children on sexual things to a point now where they're teaching perverted sexual things at an elementary level.
Right.
And then teaching that abstinence doesn't work.
Right.
I'll tell you, if you practice abstinence, you won't get pregnant.
Amen.
Some people have like and it wasn't because they weren't educated.
Right.
It was because they succumbed to youthful lust.
Right.
Instead of following after righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Now, The world will say you can't be righteous. Nobody's righteous, and the devil will even use the scripture to tell you that.
That's right.
There's a scripture in the Old Testament that says there are none righteous, no, not one, and then our righteousness is as filthy rags, and I believe that wholeheartedly when it comes to what that was talking about, but when you look through the rest of the Old Testament, there are Psalms, the righteous cry, and the Lord delivers them from all their troubles. Who's crying out? The effectual fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And so basically what we've done is we've allowed the world to define what type of Christian that we are and what type of Christianity is acceptable, and I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to let the world define my God. Amen. My God defined the world. He told the sun when to come up. Amen.
Right.
He told the ocean to only go so far.
Right.
Amen. And we can pray that it won't rain, it won't rain. So,
come
Lord,
on.
We need
a
sunshiny day. Amen.
Amen.
And before we get to the end of James, you'll see that.
That's right.
Flee youthful lust, but follow after righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart.
Amen.
If we allow the world to tell us that nobody is pure, that there are no pure people, what we've done is we have taken the Word of God and we've set it aside and we've braced cunningly devised fables and old wives' tales and vain janglings and babblings of this world that will increase to more ungodliness, because I'll tell you, if you refuse to put good things in your house, the devil's coming back and it's going to be worse
right.
than it was in the beginning.
That's exactly right.
Boy, 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 there's all kinds of messages here.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus spoke his Sermon on the Mount, what did he say? Blessed are the pure in heart.
For they shall.
Amen. But if we say nobody's pure,
right.
who's he talking about?
Right.
Who is calling out to God out of a pure heart if nobody's pure?
Right.
Who's the righteous man is praying if nobody's righteous?
Right.
We've allowed the devil to define and interpret Scripture for us.
Come on.
You need to break loose and see the light.
Come on. Amen.
Amen. He's got a calling that's high
Come
for
on.
You.
That's right.
It's to be like Him.
That's right.
It's to depart from iniquity.
Come on.
And do right.
That's right.
You say, well, Brother Scott, have you always done right? No. And I'm ashamed of it.
Come on.
Amen.
Everything I've ever done wrong before I was saved and after I was saved, I'm ashamed of it.
Right.
Amen. And godly sorrow works repentance.
That's right.
And repentance works purity.
Come on.
When you call upon the Lord and you ask Him to forgive you, He says He will.
Right.
But if we say we haven't done wrong, we do wrong.
Right.
And we're a liar. And the Bible says the truth is not in us.
That's right.
When we do wrong and we say we haven't done wrong.
Right.
That's in John.
Mm.
I didn't make that up either. Okay. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing they do gender strides. Man, there's so many messages in this book. Okay, let me give you an example of a foolish question. How much wood... You finish it.
Go to a tech shop.
Well, are we conditioned or are we conditioned? Is that a silly question? See, all of you have that ingrained in your mind, the Bible says to avoid it. He's talking about, can God lift, make a rock that's too heavy for Him to lift? Oh, my goodness. Okay, avoid foolish questions. Okay, and unlearned questions. That's rough. I imagine that's something you're going to have to discern on your own, what's foolish for you to be engaged in. If it's beyond the scripture, I am apprehensive of making judgment calls that are beyond the scripture. I'll do it if necessary by the Spirit of God. If He leads me to an answer, then I'll have that answer. And I have used it often. I'll use it again because all of us will probably agree, and that's why I use it. But I don't have to struggle with is it right or wrong, sinful or iniquity, for me to smoke crack. It's not in the Bible, but it's pretty much a settled matter in my mind. Next Sunday, I'm not going to be missing. Because I went out and thought it was okay to trade my vehicle for a high. It's not going to happen.
Right.
It's not in the Bible.
Right.
It's not in the Bible. But I've had people in the church tell me, well, Brother Scott, the Bible doesn't say that's wrong. I don't want to use the word shut up, but it just comes up so often. Avoid foolish questions. What happened to the dinosaurs?
They smoked.
Well, maybe they were smoking crack. Okay.
Prove me wrong.
What happened to the dinosaurs? I can imagine that we're not the only thing that God's ever done in the spectrum of eternity. To think that we're the only thing that God has done in the spectrum of eternity is very nearsighted and self-centered. So when He frames the worlds and says things like of the increase of His government, there shall be no end. Amen. He's got things beyond you that's going on.
Amen.
Amen. You think about it, He knows the dust ball is floating around the room, every hair that's on your head. I'm going to get into that a little later sometime. And you think about the things that He's got going on. It's eternal. That's awesome. And so to think that we're the only thing that God's ever done, so God could have a long time ago, let's say 10, 16 million years ago, He could have had a clay ball. He said, man, I'd like to see some animals running around on that thing. Man, that's a mean one. That's not working. I trust God.
Amen.
I don't trust anything other than God. Amen.
Right.
I don't trust the things I see. They can make videos and make it look like you see something that you didn't see.
Right.
I saw this little video where this eagle came by and swooped up this toddler and carried him for a little bit and then dropped him. It was a hoax. Some of you share it like it was real.
Yeah, man.
I thought it was real until I read it was a class of some videotographers that were trying to make you think it's real. You can't believe what you see half the time. You can't believe what you hear, but you can sure trust the Word of God. Amen.
Right.
And you can trust the Spirit of God to lead and guide you into all truth, and He will. I haven't been even going an hour yet, and you all are tired. A good thing we're about at the end of the chapter, but there's another chapter after that. Avoid foolish questions. Now, I think, in my mind, I'm thinking that the world was without form and void. That could have gone on a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I can think of, the Gulf of Mexico. I saw some satellite imagery or some topographical information. What it looks like is that a catastrophic asteroid hit near the coast of Brazil and caused this a cataclysmic event that started an ice age, which makes sense to me. If you find a woolly mammoth with grass in his mouth frozen, guess what? Something happened. Amen. Pretty quickly.
Amen.
He didn't see it coming. He didn't have time to build an ark. The world just changed in an instant. And let me tell you, friends, it's going to change again.
Amen.
Amen.
You're going to have to be ready. And this time it's not a big wooden boat. Amen. Right. I was thinking the other day how they hijacked the rainbow and I don't even, you know, but God sent the rainbow. It's never going to destroy the earth. That don't mean it ain't going to rain again tomorrow. He said it's never going to destroy the earth like that again. But
right.
I'm thinking what's going to be the next one, a smoke bowl? I'm talking about because this earth one day is going to burn like an oven, and
that's
all
right.
That stuff's going to go somewhere. As a matter of fact, one of the scriptures in Revelation said the smoke's going to rise forever of the things that were wicked on this world. And so are we going to look to the horizon and see a smoke bowl?
Mm.
I didn't say smoke bowl. A bowl.
Smoke bowl.
A bow. I know from the country. Bow and bow are very close. But think about it. This world is going to change cataclysmically. Malachi says, behold, a day is going to come, it's going to burn as an oven, and yea, all that do wickedly are going to burn up, and the righteous are going to go forth, and they're going to be like stubble or ash under the feet of the righteous. But unto them that love the Lord or fear His name,
amen,
or look for His coming, they're going to go and they're going to grow up as calves of the stall, and the Lord's going to take care of you in such a way that is unfathomable to our thought process. Streets of gold, gates of pearl, walls of jasper. That sounds beautiful, amen, but that's only the beginning. That's pavement and mortar. If He takes that regard for your habitation, how much more does He love you and will give you of the abundance of His goodness? How often would He have gathered you in? And He says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. Noah was building a boat for a long time, and we've been building a church for a long time and telling people, get in.
Right.
Get in.
Right.
Get in.
Come on.
But they would not.
Mm.
And then one day when God shuts the door and the three men I admire most take the last train for the coast, music refuses to play. You go down to the sacred stores and the bell is broken. Let me tell you, Don McLean was used by God to pen that song.
Yeah.
Because when the Spirit of the Lord withdraws from this world and the presence of the God is revealed,
oof.
Anyway, that's a cycle. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle to all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those who oppose themselves. They don't even know they're lost.
Right, right.
If God, peradventure, or perhaps, will give them repentance to acknowledging of the truth, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. This world is blinded by the deceptive nature of our enemy. Some of you, when you wake up to righteousness and you begin to sin not, you'll understand a little bit better what I'm talking about. But when the Bible says, depart from iniquity and pursue the things of righteousness and to flee youthful lust, that's not just some good advice. That's the Word of God.
Amen.
It defines who you are. You know that you are defined by what you do.
Right.
If you're a thief, you're defined by being a thief. Amen? If you're saved, you need to be defined by being saved, and you need to be identified with the sanctified.
Come on.
Amen.
The called out.
Amen.
The church. The bride of Christ. When you begin to think about it in your mind, I think of some of the words that have been described in Ephesians. The Bible uses a focal verse that we use often in weddings, that Christ loved the church. He says a husband should love his wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it, purify it by the washing of water, the word. See, you get into this study and then you will begin to knock some things off that you didn't think have to go, that you thought you could hold on to. But let me tell you, you let it all go, and God will begin to use you in dramatic fashion. And what will He use you for? To save souls and to help people recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. And some of the people you work with, some of the people you live beside, if you don't reach them, somebody might not.
That's right.
We had a brother Dean that was preaching yesterday, and he said that anytime he asks for help, people say, get somebody else. And he said he looked on the church rolls under else, and there was nobody named somebody else. If you don't listen to the call
right.
of God on your life, and purge yourself from the things that are displeasing to Him, and live a life that's sanctified to Him, He won't be able to use you like He wants to use you. Now, He can do anything He wants to do.
Right.
If He wants, I need to put caveats in here, but I don't want to be a donkey that cries out.
Amen.
You know, God can do that.
Mm-hmm.
God can use the trees to talk. He can use the rocks to cry out. If he says He can raise up, because dust from dust we came and to dust we'll return. And if God wants to make a rock powder and have somebody that'll raise up and be a child that He's called them to be, God's looking for children that will call Him Father, and that He's not ashamed to call them children.
Right.
Amen. Mm. Would you stand with me?